Gillard government is finally getting some traction and is daring to dream. First, this week, finally passed its carbon dioxide tax.
Today, we have made history. After all of these years of debate and division, our nation has got the job done.
The government used this to sell a new line on a woman the public hasn't warmed to, but might just give credit for being tough.
The reason that this legislation is passing is because the PM is as tough as nails.
The Prime Minister will now hope she can at least sell her hated tax as a tough call and move on. And she is indeed moving on, literally. Just back from the G20 meeting at Cannes, she's now in Hawaii. Now, the APEC meeting about trade. And on Armistice Day, the government leaked news that President Barack Obama would, on his visit this week, announce US Marines would rotate through Darwin. That's war talk that makes even a woman of the left seem tough as nails. And on every front, Labor has gone tough on its critics. Last week, it slimed Qantas CEO Alan Joyce as a bastard boss. This week, it suggested mining magnate Twiggy Forrest, a critic of its new mining tax, was a tax avoider.
I think Australians would look at a company like this company, Twiggy's company, which hasn't paid any company tax as yet, but is arguing that they don't want the mining tax.
Resources Minister Martin Ferguson was one of several ministers to whack the Greens, saying they lived in a fantasy land for pretending we could soon stop using coal. And Labor has also gone tough in that old pro-union way, not just attacking bosses and miners, but promising $2 billion for big wage rises for social and community sector workers.
The people who work in your female-dominated sector have long been underpaid.
Getting tough, moving on, and it's working, at least in the polls. 2 months ago, News Poll had the Coalition's lead over Labor at an astonishing 18 points. This week it was down to 6. And the pressure is being turned onto opposition leader Tony Abbott, now portrayed by Labor as weak for having gone to a London conference rather than stay to watch senators vote on the carbon tax.
We've had the leader of the opposition take off with his tail between his legs today after all of the tough guy talk.
Playground insults. But Abbott will soon have to explain more his own vision. We know what he's against, but what's he for? He's backed off a fight over the bad workplace laws that created the Qantas grounding and has weakened the Liberals' free trade position by calling for new anti-dumping laws. It may be time Abbott showed how tough he is too. The Gillard government this week finally passed its carbon dioxide tax to help stop global warming, just as a rainstorm hit Canberra.
Even the heavens are clapping.
Clapping or mocking? Fact is, we've been told by Chief Climate Commissioner Tim Flannery that global warming had dried the rains and drained our dams, quote, to the point where they're now affecting the future of some of our cities.
Even the rain that falls isn't actually going to fill our dams and our river systems.
Joining me is Flannery's fellow Climate Commissioner, Professor Will Steffen. I appreciate your time, Professor. Now,
thank you,
one
Andrew.
Thing that makes me so sceptical that we're heating the world dangerously are these sorts of exaggerations. Have alarmists like Professor Flannery hurt your cause?
Well, I think you have to bear in mind that these are projections for the future. And around rainfall, there is some uncertainty. Now, what he was referring to was the southern part of Australia. And there is a risk that we will see continued drying, the recent El Nino-driven rain notwithstanding. But you're absolutely right. There is a lot of uncertainty about rainfall change, how it's going to pan out around much of our continent.
Can we put to bed some of the other scares that people like Tim Flannery have blamed man-made warming for causing more and worse hurricanes and cyclones? But according to your own recent report, there's no proof of that at all, is there?
No, there's no statistically significant evidence that we've seen a change in the behaviour of tropical cyclones around the world. Most experts agree, however, that we will see an increase in intensity in these cyclones as the warming continues.
But as yet, your own report says it's not possible, and I'm quoting, to attribute any aspect of changes in cyclone behaviour, frequency, intensity, rainfall, etc., to climate change.
That's correct.
We've also been told by this government that the recent drought in the Murray-Darling Basin was caused by global warming. Again, your own report says there's nothing unusual about that drought either. Is that true?
We've had very severe droughts before, so again, we cannot attribute this drought statistically to climate change. However, I do want to point out that as the temperature warms, the droughts will become more severe simply because plants and animals will be subject to higher temperatures, and that stresses them as well as lack of rainfall. So we'll continue to have a continent of droughts and flooding rains, but as the temperature rises, this will place more stress on our animals, plants and social systems.
The predictions are one thing. I'm talking really about the alarmism before, like when Penny Wong was climate change minister, she actually did say this severe extended drought is clearly linked with global warming, and now we say actually it's not.
No, I think the jury's still out on that, Andrew. As I said, rainfall is a very tricky thing to both attribute and project, much more complex than temperature. So we scientists tend to be rather cautious before making such claims.
More cautious than Penny Wong. Has, in fact, there been any pause in the global warming over the past decade? It seems to me for a decade the temperature has levelled out, the seas have cooled over the last few years, sea levels have dropped since about 2003. Has this made you rethink just how much man is, in fact, changing the climate?
Well, some of those observations, I think, Andrew, are incorrect if you actually look at the peer-reviewed literature. The oceans have not stopped warming. In fact, the heat content of the ocean has been rising steadily through this last decade.
Not over the last few years, Professor.
No, they have. The latest data I've seen that go through to 2008, 2009, the warming has indeed continued. Sea levels have continued to rise as well. They're rising at about 3.2 millimetres per year, and that rate has increased over the last couple of decades. The other point I will make is there's obviously a lot of natural variability in the climate system, which still continues to operate. So we never, ever look at long-term climate trends on a few years. In my view, you need a minimum of three decades, and if you have more than three decades, that's much better. When you look at it on in that time frame, there's absolutely no doubt the climate system is continuing to warm precisely as we expect.
Well, in fact, Professor Judith Curry, who's not a skeptic, she chairs the Department of Earth and Atmospheric Science at Georgia University of Technology, has said this concept of a recent pause in the warming seems to be fairly widely accepted by many mainstream consensus scientists. And like, for example, the sea level rises, the Envirosat, I think, satellite, maintained by the Europeans, says there's been no rise since 2003. So there is a consensus that there has been no warming over the decade.
No, I think to be fair to Professor Curry, I think she was referring to air temperature, which is actually a very small component of where the extra heat is actually going into the Earth's surface. When you look at the entire climate system, the ice, the ocean, the land and the atmosphere, it's continuing to warm over the past decade. So I think we need to be careful about what part of the climate system we're actually talking about.
And can I ask you finally, the carbon dioxide tax cutting our temperatures, our emissions by 5% to 2020, how much to the nearest degree do you think that will actually cut global temperatures?
Well, that's not a calculation that we make. In fact, it's not a question that we ask. The question we ask in science is, at what level can we stabilize the climate system? Is it going to be 2 degrees above pre-industrial, 3 or 4? That's the question.
But it's going to make a difference.
So yes, and I think what we need to say is two things about the 5% target. One, it's actually a very ambitious target in terms of per capita emission reductions from today. It's more like 25 or 30%, which is significant. Second of all, it's a first important step on a longer pathway to going toward decarbonized economies. And the third point is Australia is seen as a major player. We're one of the 20 largest emitters in the world, and we're expected to do our fair share, just like we do in other international issues like Afghanistan.
Professor Stephan, thank you so much for coming on the show.
My pleasure. Thanks for having me, Andrew.